He is extending a very warm welcome to everyone who's logged in on this Saturday afternoon, giving us a chance to spend the next 45 minutes with you. I'm your host for the session, Aditi Chandak, a chartered accountant during the week and a writer by the weekend, sprinkled with experience in emceeing and Toastmasters keynote speaking events. I've been writing for the better part of my life, first as a student blogger, then a journalist, and recently a published author. My debut novel, Under the Crescent Moon, is available on both Amazon and Flipkart, and it was published last year. This session is being presented by The Secret Bookshelf. It's an online bookstore that promotes Indian authors and holds a virtual book club as well. To thank you for your presence, they're offering a 20% discount on their website till the end of this month, that is September 2021. The code is DBF20. I'll repeat the code again while you find a pen to scribble it or, you know, open a chat to type out to a friend on WhatsApp. The code is DBF for Delhi Book Fair 2020. Anyway, enough about us. It's time to introduce to you the amazing panelists we have here to discuss Obligation Trumps Passion. Please welcome, in no particular order, Ms. Naseha Sameen, Ms. Purvi Mehta, and Mr. Sarbajit Chaudhary.
Thank you.
Ms. Sameen, a data scientist and an emerging writer, was born in Cuttack. Her journey as an author began with Invincible Publishers publishing two of her books, Air, End of Innocence, and Air, Dawn of Deception. Her readers love her distinct writing style and presentation. She has won Author Page Awards for Best Debut and Best Woman Writer, Author of the Year 2020 by Ispiro Awards, and is recognized as one of the 100 Prime Authors 2021. Her work has been featured in 19 different anthologies and sites, and she believes her journey has just begun. Welcome, Ms. Sameen.
Thank you, Aditi. Call me Naseha.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Chaudhary is an alumnus of St. Xavier's College and School, Burdwan. He has completed his master's from University of Burdwan. He is the author of an anthology of poems, Speaking from the Autumn of My Life. He has been awarded with the Indian Literary Award 2020, Sahitya Kosh Samman Award 2021, and Indian Prime Author Award 2021. He has been featured by the Times of India and the News Now. Welcome, Mr. Chaudhary.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your kind information. Thank you so much.
Ms. Mehta, apart from having authored an award-winning book, When Fate Conspires, is also an educator and a soft skills trainer. She has been invited by several student bodies for her soft skill sessions. Passionately associated with the field of academics for over 24 years, she has mentored a multitude of both students and teachers. She has great love for art, philosophy, reading, and her students. Her book has been covered in top 10 books of the Outlook and presented with Tagore Commemorative and Sahitya Award by NetEdX LitFest 2021. Welcome, Ms. Mehta.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
So going ahead, I would want to ask you some questions about your book, your work, and you know how your journey as an author has really developed over the years. We would all be excited to hear about that. But let me just begin with one question each about the work that you've done so far, and most importantly, the latest book that has been released by you. So beginning with Naseha, like she said, I can call her Nas or Naseha. So Naseha, the premise of your book, Air, End of Innocence, sounds quite promising. Which era is it based in? And how did you draw inspiration for the characters and the settings of a relevant period, you know, being in 2021, the kind of urban city life that we are more used to? How did you really draw that period inspiration?
So this book is basically set up in 15th century India. Mm-hmm. And there is a element of romanticism in those eras where you don't have lights and we are not connected. The life is not very easy, right. But at the same time, it has its own charm. So I generally escape from the real world after 5 days of work, which you can very well understand, to a different world altogether. So it was very, I mean, I generally go to that kind of world where life is simple, but characters are complex.
Exactly. Okay. I like how you put it. Your life is simple, but it's the characters that are complex. So it just helps you bring out the nuances into your characters.
Right. Okay. So that's how it started building up. And the whole theme was a conflict of this young girl of 16 years old between her duties as a princess and what she wants from her life. And if I would have put that into a current scenario, it would have become a little too realistic for my taste.
Hits you in the gut.
Yeah. So, and it was first time I was trying to do something like that. So I was in my comfort zone, wherein I generally escape to from this hard world reality.
Right.
So, so that's how the whole setup came up. Okay. Thankfully, Dawn of Deception is the finale to that. Whole story, and I'm keeping my fingers crossed that you guys will love it.
Okay, so is this a trilogy?
No, it's just two parts.
Okay, that's nice. So Air End of Innocence and Air End of Deception.
No, Air End of Innocence and Dawn of Deception.
Oh, sorry, Dawn of Deception. My bad. Okay. Okay. No. So is Dawn of Deception out, or are we?
Yes.
Okay.
It's,
wow.
Last week.
Oh, that's great. Congratulations. That's great
Thank
news.
Thank you.
So where are these available? I mean, where can someone buy it apart from the nearest bookstore, of course?
Amazon.
Okay. That's
and
great.
I have a smart URL.
Okay.
smarturl.it/air and smarturl.it/air2.
Okay. Easy great. I'll have to understand from you how to do that smart URL thing.
Anytime, Aditi.
Sure. So, okay, let's move on to Sarvajit. I've been very, very excited about the fact that you ended up writing an anthology of poems, because honestly, me, I see myself more of as a prose writer, or, you know, a novella or a novel at max, you know, it depends on how much you can actually put in place for one story. But poetry is something that I cherish reading, but haven't been able to really, you know, get my mind to writing it that well. So, Sarvajit, the 44 poems that you have in your book, you know, speaking from the autumn of my life, that for me, it would be a work of a lifetime. So how long did it take you to put it all together?
Actually, you know, I have been a kind of a person who have been always contemplating things, you know. And unfortunately or fortunately, I have been a person who have a lot of dark experiences at a very early age. Matlab, I couldn't enjoy my childhood due to some personal reasons. So for that reason, I had a lot of baggage of emotions, which came out in the form of poems very early in my life, you know. So I used to write small here and there. But on my third year of college, I accumulated near about 30 poems. So I was like, okay, so... Actually, poetry was my way of expressing grief, you know, whatever emotional baggage it was, to let it go, let it out. Poetry was my only way of conveyance to it. So in that way, maybe that way it accumulated to 44 poems, you know, bringing it all together in anthology was very difficult because individually it has been there. So collecting all the poems over the years from here and there and putting it into a file and submitting, that was a big
challenge. Right. Okay, so this actually for you, it has been the work of your lifetime up till now, if I could put it that way.
It is my first, and it is very special to me too, because, you know, seldom we put out our heart, you know, to the world to read
right.
it, or to put our experiences out to the world to read it. So in that
yeah,
case,
it's difficult to be vulnerable. And in your case, you know, it must have been tough for you. But kudos to you that you actually managed to, you know, reach out to the world with your writing.
Yeah, thank you so much. So. In that way, it was a bit challenging. I was a bit skeptical, you know, because judgments are always around you. So, but then I thought, let it go. That will bring some ease.
So anything that maybe you could read out for us, if you'd be comfortable?
A little bit later in the session, because...
Absolutely. We'll hold you to it.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Sarvajit. Yes, Purvi. Hi. Sorry to have kept you waiting for so long.
Absolutely. It's a pleasure hearing that.
Great. So if I manage to read just the blurb of your book, I will get to reading the book as well as soon as I finish the one I'm reading currently. So the blurb says, will their fates sink them in their own emotional tsunamis? And that just sounds like such a roller coaster story filled with emotions. You've not shied away from, you know, it seems like that. You've not shied away from packing them with emotions. So tell us more about it. I mean, what is this emotional tsunami?
Yeah, you guessed absolutely right. I haven't shied away at all from putting them into a roller coaster ride of emotions. Actually, a variety of emotions are covered. There was a lot going on in the head with respect to all these characters that I've drawn up in the novel. And it was very apt, you know, putting them through all this. So it is somewhere, it is, you know, the hype of friendship. Somewhere it is, okay, you know, somebody is, you know, ditching the other one. Or somewhere it is all the love triangle coming up. And there are duties and obligations, which also, you know, somewhere connects to our theme for today.
Of course.
So life is packed with so many variety of things. Inevitably, we have to deal with so many things in our life. And the story actually does that. And we, I was able to bring out all of that variety of things that a person has to face in a lifetime. Maybe not all, but at least right, a few. And so that gave wonderful twists and turns to the story. Characters go through a lot. And it really feels very good when I, you know, get this review from the readers saying that, okay, it was unpredictable and so is life, you know, that's why I absolutely put it like that.
Yeah. So what age are the characters, like, what age group are they in?
They are around 25.
Okay. So would I be right to say that some of it has been inspired by the students that you've been teaching for so long?
Yeah, maybe. Actually, I have this habit of observing things around and then picking them up from here and there. And yeah, that's how you can build up wonderful things.
Absolutely. Yeah, of course, it would help. I mean, considering you've been around students for so long, it just gives you a very fresh and, you know, retains the innocent perspective to life.
Yeah.
In fact,
you know, our perspective gets freshened up every time, every year. We get to learn so much from our children that, you know, you hardly feel old. So that's the plus side of it.
Okay, great. No one would call you old anyway. So let's not go there.
Thanks.
Yeah. So great. I mean, this has been a very short and crisp introduction about our panelists, and we've heard from them about the latest books. But now let's come to what we're here to discuss today. And that is a very heavy topic, if you'd ask me, you know, obligation trumps passion. All three words, you know, they have their own meaning. They have their own way of interpretation. And for the next 20 to 25 minutes, and I would love it if the audience could post in their questions in between, which hopefully someone from the team will be looking at. Meanwhile, we'll be discussing the questions that I have, you know, kind of built around the topic and my understanding of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pose a few questions at the beginning to two of you out of the three, so that, you know, we get to hear a different perspective, and it could be more of a discussion sort of thing in two people. So if Naseha and Purvi, you would like to go first, then the question that I have for you first, and let's hope it's going to be interesting, is as follows. Do you think following your passion is dead? Or has the meaning of passion simply changed in today's world? Because everywhere around us, people seem to be choosing passions which could become a side hustle, which could be where someone could earn out of. Because if I'm spending my time doing something, I might as well earn out of it. That seems to be, you know, the going statement from people. Even when I write, or even you might have heard probably, that when you've written a book, the first thing people ask is, how much did you earn out of it? And how do you explain to them that this wasn't because I wanted to make it a side hustle? This is something because I did this because I wanted to do it. So what do you think? Is the traditional form of passion dead? Or is this just, you know, passion evolving over the ages? Naseha, if you could go first probably.
Okay. So it's rather a little complicated, Aditi, when I look at it, because at one point of time, for me, nothing mattered more than obligation. And one day it was a realization, and I realized I was not living at all. And then I moved towards my passion. But having said that, subconsciously we keep our passions alive. Like, nobody in my family except my mom knew that I was writing till I came to Gurgaon, and my partner happened to read my story air, and he was like, are you crazy? It should go out. I said, I can't do all this marketing. I'm not meant for this. I'm okay with my job. I'm earning enough, touch wood, for it. And this is, I can't monetize it. He said, who is asking you to? Then, and that's how I got the courage to send it to the publishers.
Right.
Till then, I was always living under the shadow that I can't tell. I loved telling stories as a kid, and I was always laughed at and bullied, and you know, all that sort that happens in B towns with kids. That happened. So I never had that courage even to go out and say that, yeah, I like writing. And the whole way I was described as a duty bound girl, so dutiful, so nice. And so it was my life, responsible, doing everything by the books.
Right.
So that's what, and even today, I don't think I can leave my job, because I have a list of obligations to meet. Right. And I have to live. And I am not that courageous that I can leave everything and run after my passion. But I balance that out. I pursued my passion in secret. Thankfully, now I'm out and open. But
coming out of the closet in a different way altogether.
In a different way altogether.
Yes.
And nobody till 2019 knew that I was writing.
Wow.
Okay. And they were like, is it you or is it somebody else?
Yeah, we never knew this was a part of your life.
Yeah. And it's like, you can't even speak one sentence clearly. You stammer, right. And you have written a book. So that's what it is. At times, we don't have that much of bandwidth to follow our passion end to end.
But it's not always necessarily a side hustle. So you're saying,
yeah.
this is not right. Maybe the majority is looking at it as a side hustle, but there's, you know, still a chunk of people just follow it because that's what they're passionate about.
Right. Got and when I picked this theme, people told me that the way you write, it reflects a little old English. It's not okay. Popular today. Change it. I said, no, I like this way. I want to put it in this way. I don't care about how much of royalty it comes back. All I want, the story should be heard.
That's it.
I feel that's good when people like to hear about that story,
right.
Like reading it. That's it.
Understand.
And it doesn't
so
matter
clearly,
at that time.
Her passion isn't dead. It's still the traditional form. But what about you, Purvi? I mean, you know, what do you think? You obviously interact with a lot of youngsters, probably much more than me and Naseha do combined. So what do you think? What's their take? What's your take?
Coming to their take, they are actually in that age group and in that position where they try to imbibe things from people like us, like you, like Naseha, like Sarbjeet and me. So they are looking at us, you know. So somewhere we have that obligation on our shoulders that we give out the right message. But currently what is more popular is, if you must have heard about the term Ikigai. It's a Japanese philosophy.
Yes. Yeah.
But it has taken up so much of attention from people, and everyone is like, you know, trying to get that Ikigai. Now, when we follow that Ikigai concept, the traditional form of passion somewhere is being lost. Mm. Somewhere it loses the value. So, and I totally agree with Naseha where she said that, you know, following your passion, doing certain things for your core, for yourself, for your own satisfaction is absolutely necessary.
Right.
So somewhere, you know, when we teach the children to find their ikigai, follow their passion, make the passion into a paycheck, all of this is really very nice. It sounds very good. But it is on the same track, you know, we also have to show them the parallel line.
Absolutely.
That it would be okay if you cannot convert your passion into a paycheck.
Absolutely.
You can fulfill your obligations, like Nasiha said, we all have a list of things. And we are fulfilling them the best to the best of our abilities, and we should keep doing it. You know, so we are supposed to leave out this message for the youngsters as well, that follow your pathway to fulfill the obligations that you're supposed to. If you can convert the passion into paycheck, wonderful, it's a win-win. But just in case it doesn't work out like that, please do not let go of your passion.
Right.
It is going to be your, you know, lifeline.
Interesting, very interesting. So maybe the take that I had, you know, where people are just looking to convert it into side hustle, that exists, but we also have this chunk that we're trying to preserve and, you know, tell them that it's okay not to try and succeed in everything that you do, or try and make it into make it into a side income that you might have, like not look at monetizing everything.
Exactly.
So I hope we have, you know, teachers like you who can just keep imbibing that value, because obviously students do look up to teachers, and you know they do become role models at the end of the day. At least for me, they were. So I hope that still continues. Sarbjit, what do you have to say? If I told you, you know, you have one life, Sarbjit. Would you want to live it your way, or would you want to be tied down with duty? Like, what would you prefer? Where's the line between that whole obligation?
I personally have always followed my heart.
Okay.
That has been my way of life since very beginning.
Okay.
I'm the only child of the family. So I was very laden with the dreams and hopes of lots of people. My grandparents, my parents, they have always thought that I would be a doctor, I would be an engineer, or I would be somebody with a huge paycheck and would be doing, you know, could we put family's name somewhere else? But I was the person who went adamantly and told that, no, I will take arts because that's what I love. I love to study arts. I love to study, I love to study humanities. I love English. I will go that way. So I have always followed my heart. Yes, I have certain set of duties being the only child towards my parents. For that, I need an income. So for me, my writing has always been my plan A. That this is where I want to excel.
Wow.
But
okay.
But I have certain duties which I need to fulfill, for that I need a certain amount of income, which
absolutely.
I can earn with my degrees, and I will earn that. But my plan A has always been being a writer, and still, touch wood, I am still fighting, you know, to reach somewhere, at least. In a,
yeah, everything in life.
In this, yeah, it takes time, and you know, even in this career as a writer, it takes a lot of time to stand out. So
absolutely.
I'm waiting still.
So this is so great. So what he's done is, he's like, I know what my passion is. I'm going to make sure that my obligation actually funds my passion.
Exactly.
I will not make my obligation my plan, which is brilliant. I mean, I had never given it a thought like that.
Yeah, because, you know, at the end of the day, you have duties. You cannot just throw them away, because right now, I'm a young adult. I'm a 24 years of old. So I cannot just say that, no, I will take no duties of my family and I will just run after my passion.
Mm-hmm.
I have to take. But
that's
not everything. Come on, I have a life. I have to live it. Otherwise, I'm going to blame my parents 10 years later, telling them, you didn't allow me to follow your passion. I don't want to do that. It's okay if I don't make here. It's okay. I have a plan B to excel there. So, you know, it's always, I don't fall in the pit. I have a cushion to protect.
I mean, Purvi, I think you would agree that that's a clarity of thought that we rarely come across.
Absolutely, yeah. And at this age, he is having that clarity, which is wonderful. You know, his childhood experiences, like he just mentioned, is supporting him. It is fueling his right path.
Thank you so much, Purvi. This is really great. Thank you.
That's great, Sarbjit. So, Nasiha, if you had one life, what would you do? I mean, we all do have one life. We know that, right? So it's not an if anyway. So far, you've obviously, as you mentioned, you've been by the book and you followed all the rules. You've done what people expected of you. going forward, do you see, you know, maybe next 5 years, next 10 years, do you see yourself as more of a rebel, or are you just going to silently keep writing and, you know,
So I think I have crossed that age of being a rebel also, and then going back, being a dutiful daughter, then a rebel, saying I had my duties. That's why I wanted to run away from home. And well, it's a confession in the mainstream.
We all want to at some point.
Yeah.
We all want to.
Absolutely.
So I thought that what's the best way to run away from home? Find a job in the most different location. Right. So from Odisha, I jumped to Gurgaon.
Mm-hmm.
24 hours really journey. Great. So that's how I, and then my people said, you can't live alone. I said, try me. So that was a phase wherein I was a very big rebel. For years, a lot of my relatives did not even speak to me. We were not in speaking terms. And I said, I will do what I want to do right now. After 25, 26 years, I realized what I like doing.
Mm-hmm.
And that time it was my job. And I still love my job like crazy. If I have, I mean, data analytics is like storytelling.
Right. It's just with numbers. I would know.
So, and then it, then I, whatever I have learned was because of this failures I had during those years, the kind of hard realities that came up.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
So today, if I look back and if I have to change anything, I'll not change a thing.
Right.
Maybe just write a letter to my old self saying that please do not be into this inferiority complex anymore. Mm-hmm. You have something, just keep on, keep hanging right there.
Wow.
I will not change, even if it is so late. Like I knocked at 40s when I published my first book. Mm-hmm. And when I look at Sarbjeet and he's so clear in his thoughts, it's right, so nice. I was in the whirlpool of emotions and conflicts at that time. But those were necessary,
mm-hmm,
for me to evolve as a person, to be what I am today. And I have a long way to go. So, yeah, I'll not change anything. I'll keep on writing. I'll keep on sending it to different platforms, making it visible. But at the same time, I'm not really looking at the results that it'll right get.
Mm-hmm.
I want it to touch hearts, not the wallet.
Wow. That's so nice.
So, and if it is able to inspire one or two girls to stand out and tell everybody in their mm-hmm families that please don't push us in the right name of obligation, that you are a girl, you have to fulfill all the duties.
Mm-hmm.
I have my life. I would say that somewhere I'm successful in this life.
Absolutely. That makes sense. And success should be your parameter. You know, it has nothing to do with what they think is your parameter of success. Wow, that's really nice. So, okay, interesting question. And just think about it maybe for 30 seconds. If we all followed obligations, what work forms do you think would die out? What wouldn't exist at all if we were all looking at obligations? And this is not just financial obligations. I mean, women obviously have a lot of other obligations except financial obligations. I think we have all obligations other than financial obligations. So what forms of work, or let me not give a hint, but what forms of work would die out?
Poetry would die, I think.
Okay.
Because it's from heart. You feel you... Sufism would die.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Similarly, sorry, continue. Yeah.
No. And when these two are dead, I don't think I will anyway enjoy living at all.
What were you saying?
Yeah, I was about to add, music would suffer, you know. Music would suffer a lot. Similarly, the Urdu Shairi the Nazm, all of that entire genre.
A lot of works of art, basically.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. And along with that, when we think about obligations more, maybe certain professions like teaching, I would like to say, wherein you'll come across so many teachers throughout India, especially India, where, you know, they are into this profession because they are able to add value, because it is their passion. They are not there for the paycheck, because probably the paycheck does not suffice. So, you know, even that field would suffer. So there are going to be many fields that would suffer, you know, if at all we would stop following our passion.
Sarbjit, what do you think?
I think, you know, art forms would suffer a lot, be it a dance, be it dramas, a lot of things would suffer because, you know, I feel obligations make people more practical. And in the film, and in the field where we belong, like, you know, any kind of creative thing, that's poetry, writing, novels, short story writing, you know, that all thrives on imagination, that all thrives on courage, that all thrives on passion. So I think all of that would vanish. Is, you know, that everything would turn mechanical. And come on, we are not machines. We are humans. We have our creativity. Would love to live a creative life. You know, we cannot be machines, like waking up in the morning and just doing all things mechanically. You know? Beauty of life, aesthetic sense of an individuality, of an individual would, you know. I think every person at certain age develops their own aesthetic. If, you know, we only wake up in the morning and sleep in the night the whole day, meeting only obligations that we have to face, you know. And let's say a day-to-day duties, if we only start doing that and taking that to be only the part of our life, you know, we would stop enjoying life. We won't enjoy Fateh Ali Khan. We won't enjoy Arijit Singh. We won't enjoy maybe a Rohit Shetty film or maybe a Sanjay Leela Bhansali drama. We won't enjoy it. We would just sit there for the sake of seeing a film, you know. I think all that imaginative or that spontaneity of imagination would vanish if we only think of meeting obligations, because that's there, but we need to live our life.
So in a sense, how we want to relax after having fulfilled our obligations would all die out. If all of us just decided to, you know, go ahead with our obligations, then we would have no music, no poetry, no art forms, no theater.
Because I have never seen a poet say, ki I have written a poem to meet the obligation. I have never heard a single
saying. Yeah, I need to pay my next bill, you know. I think I should finish a poem.
After some years, I think even the economy crumble.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're right, actually.
Yeah, and even, you know, I have not heard a novelist say, okay, I have to pay my bills, that's why I have written a novel, you know. Of course,
we all know not many bills get paid.
exactly, you know.
None rather.
So that's my point, you know.
To add to what Sarbjit said, you know, he's absolutely right that we would all become machines. And, you know, eventually that would take down even the obligation. We won't be able to survive. Exactly. We won't be able to excel in anything.
Exactly. Yeah, that would become a burden for us. Complete burden for us.
Because the economy would start tumbling. You'll burn out. Yes. At the end of the day, we are humans. We'll start burning out.
Exactly.
So that's definitely going to happen.
Exactly. For me,
a lot of money is made by entertainment media.
That's
and imagine if that goes away, a lot of unemployment, crime rate goes up. I don't know. We will descend into dystopian world.
Exactly. You know, just imagine one day that all the paps vanished. Now, what do you do? We don't get updates, you know. And what I feel also is that obligations, you know, we have to meet. That is a compulsory part of life. You cannot turn away, because we all, as an individual, have a duty. For example, for me, what happens is when I have a very hectic day, a very tiresome day, I just take 5 minutes out at the end to sit, to enjoy music, to have a cup of beautifully made tea by myself. I would write something if I want to. That's how we, you know, we relax. We cannot be always meeting our obligations. We are human. We need that time.
It's like, you know, you move from point A to point B in a car, and it's a wonderful journey. You're enjoying, you're fulfilling your obligations. Everything is great. But then if you would deny pausing at a petrol pump or a gas station, you're not going to go long.
Absolutely. Exactly. Yeah.
So our passion is our gas station.
Exactly. She said it very,
very
beautifully.
True. Yes. Yes. Very
That's
true.
Really nice.
We need to passions recharge us.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, nobody could have put it in any better way. To yeah. read, it's amazing.
Thank yeah, yeah. Nice. The example is amazing.
That's really nice. So, you know, from a personal perspective, obviously, I've come to understand that you all obviously are passionate about it, and that's why you write. But from a personal point of view, you know, it's difficult. See, everyone has their own jobs. You have full-time jobs. You have families to look after. Sometimes just untold events also happen. You're not in the zone to write. How do you personally balance it out? You know, because obviously, like she said, it's the gas station, which makes sure that we cover the whole journey of life. So how do you balance between obligation and passion? Were there instances when you had to choose one over the two, or were there instances when you had to let go of your passion and you recuperated from there? Just so that our audience understands, you know, it's not always an easy road. We look like we're sitting and laughing about, you know, how we're so passionate about writing, but there are stories behind it. So, you know, if you could share a couple of those instances. Yeah.
Okay, so may I begin first?
Yeah, yeah, please.
Yeah. So, you know, I have recently completed my master's. So that's a full-time thing. You right. cannot take it easily. Mujhe laga tha, aise chutkiyon mein ho jayega master's, you know? Aise, just, I will do this way. I will follow writing. But nahin hua. There were times when I had to let go of projects.
Right.
That would have broken me because I have let go of huge projects. Because I couldn't take that risk that I can skip a semester and follow my project. Mm-hmm. I had to let go of my project. So, you know, ultimately it's a 24-hour, it's a 12-month. You don't have time more than that. So we have to, and we are humans. So we have to divide, you know. We have to divide, and personally we have to think how we can balance. For me, it's that... okay, I will take a project, but if my plan B also has to be as good as plan A, if I'm a writer, if I'm also trying to be a professor, I have to have enough qualification to be a professor. I cannot let go that way. So, agar uske liye mere haath se ek project chhootta hai, theek hai, chhootne do. I will get something bigger maybe the next time.
Right.
So, for example, when the book came out, it was, I think in Delhi only, there was a book fair where my book got was about to be featured. Okay. And the exam, the day it was about to be featured, and there was a book launch kind of a thing.
Okay.
I couldn't attend it because that day, that day was my first semester, first exam.
Oh, God. Okay.
So I have to let go the opportunity of my first book launch.
Wow, that must have been so tough.
So tough. After giving exam, I cried for a whole 2 hours because that's the first experience and I had to let it go.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's life. You cannot have it. We cannot always have it all.
Right.
And for example, when I was giving my final semester, I have 4 or 5 projects pipeline. I was very scared because I have just started the projects and my suddenly my exam came 2 months before. It got preponed 2 months before.
Okay.
I was like, how do I balance this? But publishers, well, I was lucky with blessed publishers, you know, that they decided, okay, you complete your exams, then we will start again. So, you know, it's how we balance ultimately. It's difficult. It's absolutely not easy. I must sit here and it may seem that it's very easy. We can do this in a chutki, but no, we cannot. Sometimes you it becomes harsh, you know. Because letting go passion is not easy. It wow. takes everything. If it's like your fuel or energy, when you let it go, it takes a lot from you.
Yeah, it was one thing. I wasn't expecting such a such a deep and disturbing incident, because that's one thing we all look forward to. You know, this is that's for me at least. It was the peak of my entire journey. Yes, we launched it.
Career.
It's out. Now nothing is in my hand.
Exactly. Even 1 month, Sunila, I would share, you know, I had an interview with Times of India that day.
Okay.
So that I was very excited, you know, the person is going to call me. Oh my God. This, I thought, this, I was like, this is, I'm gonna kill it. Just before the interview, my, just 2-3 hours before, my grandmother started deteriorating. And oh. I was so surprised, like, what do I do now? But then I had my father to balance it. And then I sat for the interview and immediately ran to the hospital after that. You know, it happens. And for me,
yeah,
it's every time.
Easy,
sometimes, right. It's for me, it happens every time. When I have some big, some speed breaker has to come. So, yeah.
But you've gotten through this far. So I'm sure it's going to be better going forward as well. We're all hoping.
I hope so. Yeah. I hope just it gets easier after this. Not
absolutely.
More tough.
Absolutely. Purvi, anything that you would want to share, you know?
Yeah, sure. And I would like to add to what Sarbjeet said. Sarbjeet, I would suggest the kind of journey you already have. Don't ask for anything easy. You won't enjoy it. Because you know, when we are talking about the balance thing, every day it's not going to be possible. It is not practical that we will be able to balance passion and obligation every single day of our life. There are going to be phases, of course, and we will have to take a call. And I have personally taken such calls that I've let go on of my passion or let go on of opportunities wherein, you know, I was offered being the principal of a school or, you know, a variety of such things much earlier in my career. But because of my obligation as a mother, I had to let it go. And today, I feel so glad. I feel happy when I look at my child that, okay, she makes me proud every single moment of our life. So I am okay. It felt really bad letting go of those opportunities at that time, but it's okay. See, at the end of the day, if I'm following my obligation or I'm following my passion, what am I seeking? I'm seeking satisfaction in the core and happiness of my soul. So you need to take a call that what is it that is going to make you happy? Are you going to be able to be selfish enough to pick up your passion and let go of the obligation? Then be it. But if you are somebody who is so much emotionally attached to your obligations, your family members, then it'll be easier for you to let go of your passion.
On a macro level, what we decide, I mean, what I did was a completely U-turn. So when I looked at the life and me and my partner, thankfully, we looked at, we wanted something good in our professional life and we wanted to pursue our passion.
Right.
So, and we have only 24 hours a day.
Of course.
So that was one major thing that pushed us to take a decision and happily to be child free.
Mm-hmm.
Because once we get into that phase, I know a lot of people might take it, would not understand this at that moment, that how could you take such a call when you were so young?
Yeah.
Yeah. One of the things that was fueling this was we lived 25 years as per our parents' guidelines, fulfilling all obligation. We wanted to live for ourselves.
Right.
And the best way was not to create further more. So every day from then, it becomes easier when on a macro level, you plan your life in that way that, okay, I limit my obligation so that I have time for my passion.
Right. So and that's a good way of finding balance. Yeah.
That helped me because the career we are in, we need to upgrade ourselves every 2 years.
Okay.
I'm again pursuing a master's course.
Ah, okay.
Wow. So, yeah, like I have to study. I have to give all the tests,
right.
Projects.
You are courageous, you know. With one master degree, I am done. But you are courageous to pursue another one.
I have to, because this AI, ML world is, data science is evolving at such a rate. Otherwise, I'll become a dinosaur.
I don't know what am I then. I'm not even like being born probably. Before evolution only, you know, like you're not fitting in.
So that's how... on a macro level, it was easy for us to, and thankfully, a lot of communication helps to figure out what we actually want to do with our life. How important is A, B, C factors? Family is very important. And a lot of my friends at that time said that you will regret. But today, a lot of them have come back saying that we know. You did a right choice. Now we realize it.
Yeah, and it was a right choice for you. For them, it could have been different. So it's a different
one. It's a personal choice. And people who could do that, hats off to them. Because it's not easy. Absolutely. It's not easy. I don't know how can... I mean, the courage it takes for somebody to walk that path is immense. Right.
So that's great.
That's how we divide our life and our days. We balance it in week, if not on a daily basis, but on a weekly and monthly basis.
Got it. That is beautiful. You know, I've had so much fun listening to you all and your different perspectives. And I never thought I'd actually be able to wrap this up in such a beautiful way, where all three of you have such a different take on how obligations and passions can be balanced. And hats off to you all for doing what you are, for being great and amazing and enjoying life at the same time, you know. It gives a lot of courage to others to see that, you know, if this worked out for them, maybe my decisions won't go so wrong. So that was really, really wonderful. And I hope you all had a great time. Unfortunately, audience questions wouldn't be taken because we've spoken so much to each other and enjoyed the discussion so much that I've been told that I have only one more minute left. So... maybe hopefully next time we'll have a lot of audience questions to field in. And I hope you all had a good time. And I hope the audience had a good time. Thank you so much for being here. And wish you all the best. Take care and stay safe.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Aditi, Purvi, Sarvajit.
Thank you.
Thank you, Purvi. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. It was great.